The next algorithm that we want to consider is called the lasso algorithm. It's again an algorithm for least squares regression, but it uses a different regularizer than in rich regression. In rich regression, we use the L2 norm as a regularization. We are now going to see that we use the L1 norm, and this corresponding algorithm is going to be called lasso. Just looking at history, so we have seen that least squares regression with rich regression, like with rich, the rich regression formulation in terms of the L2 regularization is already quite old. Now this lasso is pretty new, it's from 1996. The key thing we're after in this particular regularization formalization is that we want to achieve sparsity of our solution. Sparsity means that we have all these many different parameters, W1 to WD, but ideally what we would like to achieve is that many of these parameters are zero. So we can fit D parameters, and these parameters, like each parameter WI, tells us how important this particular feature phi I of the data is. And ideally what we would like to have is that many of these parameters are exactly zero. Why would we like to have that? There are two different reasons for that. The first one is a computational reason, that's maybe not the most important one, but in fact if we want to evaluate functions and the dimension of the data is really, really large, say, I don't know, a million dimensions, then maybe if you only need to evaluate 10 of these dimensions instead of a million, that might make a difference, in particular also in many other circumstances of the algorithm, if it's not just about evaluating, but also at multiplying matrices in these kind of setups and so on. The other reason that's, I think, even more important, at least nowadays, when it comes to regularization, is the interpretability of the solution. And to understand that, consider a situation where you have, say, a medical example that you want to solve. So you have certain features of a person, you have the temperature, you have the age, you have the diet of the person, and you have measured lots of blood contents and so on. So you have all these measurements. And now you want to make a diagnosis and you want to say this person has a certain disease or he doesn't have this certain disease. Now imagine we feed our computer with, say, 200 different measurements of this person. We run rich regression or ordinary least squares regression, and then we see the vector of WIs of the solution. And many, many of the entries in this WI vector have large components. So maybe then it's for us really hard to interpret the solution. So why would it really be the case with this particular linear combination that we trust the result of this algorithm? What we would like instead is maybe the algorithm only picks, say, 10 coordinates and says, okay, what is really important is the blood pressure and the age of the person, but maybe what is not important is the diet of the person, and then we set the corresponding parameters in the optimization problem. They are going to turn out to be zero. And then if a doctor is going to look at the solution that the algorithm found for us, he can say, okay, we have 200 input variables. Out of these input variables, only these 10 are the ones that the algorithm considers. And now the doctor, with his background knowledge, can judge whether he really trusts the algorithm or whether he thinks it's really bullshit. Maybe the age doesn't have anything to do, that's well known, but the algorithm found the age, then we maybe don't trust it. Whereas the other way around, if the algorithm found the blood pressure and you've already known that the blood pressure is something that is important in relation to this disease, you might trust the algorithm more. And in particular, if in the medical domain and also in other domains where it's really important that experts look at the solution and trust what the algorithm is going to produce, this kind of interpretability is really important, and lasso is one way, at least a simple way, to try to achieve a bit of interpretability. So hang on once back. So what we want to find, so we are looking for a function at this in the same form as before, a function that is a sum of wi phi I. But what we want is that many of these coefficients wi are zero. And such a solution is called sparse. Sparse always means a vector is sparse if most of its entries are zero. So the vector w is supposed to be sparse, so most of its entries are supposed to be zero and only few of them are non-zero. Now here's a question to you, and you might think about it for a couple of minutes before you continue watching the video. What do you think would be a good regularizer if you want to enforce sparsity? So the approach we want to take is, as in rich regression, we want to say we minimize the empirical risk, plus lambda times the regularizer of the solution. So what would be the regularizer that you would pick if you were supposed to solve this problem? And maybe to help you thinking, like, the regularizer is the function that it's supposed to have a low value if the function is one that you like. Okay, so what are the functions that we like? We like to find functions where the solution vector is sparse, where the W vector is sparse. So why don't we simply say, well, as a punishment, we simply check how many components of our vector are non-zero, and we're happy if many of them are non-zero, and we're unhappy if many of them, we're happy if many of them are zero, and we are not happy if many of them are not zero, positive or negative. So the naive way of putting this would be, we, as a regularizer, we use the function that I called omega zero on the slide, which is simply, it counts for all the d-coordinates, the characteristic function of whether this particular vector value wi is zero or not. So as it's written here, this is a number between 1 and d, or between 0 and d, which tells us how many non-zero coefficients we have. This is the natural function that you would use if you want to penalize non-zero coefficients. However, this function also has big drawbacks. And again, a question to you is, what do you think are the drawbacks of this particular function in our context of regularized least squares regression? Please think about it for a second. Okay, hopefully you have found it. The problem with this function is that this is not a convex function, it's in fact a discrete function. So this function essentially just checks how many non-zero coefficients do we have. This is a discrete function, and discrete functions are always hard to optimize. And to get an intuition, just consider you have a vector w which is 0, 0, that's nice, and then you have 0.001, 2, 3, say. This is our vector. The vector all in all has 5 coordinates. 3 of them are non-zero, so we would have omega 0 of w is 3. So we have 3 non-zero components. All fine. Now observe that one of these components, the middle one, is very, very small. And it might happen that simply out of for noise reasons or for maybe convergence reasons, this parameter hasn't really been gone to zero for whatever reason. So the punishment for this vector is still 3, but now consider this vector w tilde, which is 0, 0, 0, 2, 3. And here we would have omega 0 is 2. So it's, and observe these vectors are nearly the same. There's just this one little entry that is a tiny bit different in the third coordinate after the point. For practice, it probably doesn't make any difference which of these two vectors I take, but the punishment is different for both of them. And the point is, as soon as I go from zero to any non-zero number, no matter how small the number is, the punishment jumps from 2 to 3. And this is something, it's not a continuous kind of thing. So in optimization, we are always looking for continuous things, because you want to say, I decrease a certain parameter, say I decrease the third entry of this vector, and then my punishment is going to increase. But in such a situation, you can't do that, because there are these discrete jumps. You can decrease, nothing happens, and all of a sudden you jump from 2 to 3 or from 3 to 2, depending in which direction you go. And this is what makes these kind of optimization problems so hard. So it turns out this is also the case for this optimization problem. All these optimization problems with half discrete components in there are NP-hard. So this is all nice from theory. We can say we use it as a regularizer. In practice, it is not going to work. What we're going to do instead is we're going to look at slightly different norms of the vector. And before I can explain you what we're going to do, I need to tell you what are p-norms. People in math would have seen this before. People in computer science probably have not seen it before. So here is the definition. We consider a vector w that lives in Rd. And now we define a norm. So p is a parameter. We can define it for p equals 2, p equals 1, p equals, 1.3. It's any positive number at least. And we define the p norm of a vector as this expression. This is the sum of the entries of the vector to the power of p And then we again take one, like we take the sum of all this and then take the p-th root of this thing, so to the power of 1 over p. If you consider the special case of p equals 2, this is the normal norm of a vector, the Euclidean norm, the square norm, however you want to call it. This is the sort of the standard norm that you would use in a Euclidean vector space. This would be p equals 2, but now there exist many other values for p as well, which might make use in different applications. Now there are a couple of facts. Whenever p is greater or equal to 1, this thing is in fact a norm, and it is a convex function. And if you can't remember what a norm is, a norm needs to satisfy certain axioms. You might want to look at this again, and you can try to verify that this particular function here satisfies all these norms that are these axioms that a norm has to satisfy. And so it's convex whenever p is greater or equal to 1, and this norm is then called the p-norm of a vector. Now, this is all nice if p is greater or equal to 1. If you go below 1, you can define this for any kind of p, so for example for p between 0 and 1, it turns out that this is not a norm. Please try to find out why and which kind of the properties is not satisfied. This is a good exercise. And also it's not a convex function. This is also an interesting exercise, and I also want to show you on the next slide maybe an intuitive reason why this is the case. What I show here, you need to digest it for a bit, are the unit spheres of the p-balls. So let's step back a bit. So we're here in a two-dimensional space. So you see the coordinate system, the origin of the coordinate system is in the middle. And for example, the red line is the line of those points that have Euclidean norm equals to 1. So I go again to my iPad, I draw it once more. So the red line is this one. And in Euclidean space, this red ball is the set of points which have Euclidean norm 1. So these are all the points that have norm, so the Euclidean distance is sort of the normal distance that you would have in a Euclidean vector space. And all these points on the circle have distance 1 to the origin. So what we see here is this red line on the screen is this ball. It is the set of points where the Euclidean norm, the L2 norm, is exactly 1. Now we can do exactly the same kind of plot for different values of p. So the red line, as I said, is p equals 2. Now for p equals 1, we get a different shape of this unit ball, namely this blue one. This blue diamond kind of thing, shape thing, is the unit ball if you have p equals 1. It looks different than the red one, and we are going to exploit this in a minute. The red ball and the blue ball both are convex balls, and an indication for the fact whether something is really a convex norm is the fact whether its unit ball is convex. So the blue one is a convex set, the red one is also a convex set, and in fact any p which is greater or equal to 1 produces a convex set. And I can go back maybe to the iPad. So what we have is the unit ball for the L2 norm, the unit ball for the L1 norm, which looks like this. Now if you have any norm that is between 1 and 2, it would sit between these two balls. So maybe I can try an orange one. So here maybe that's p equals 1.5. It sits like, my drawing is not really perfect, it sits between the two black lines of the 1 norm and the 2 norm. You can also go beyond 2. For example, we can try to do this one. So if we go, say if you have p equals 5, it might look like this. It gets sort of outside of this black ball of the 2 norm. And as you can see on the screen, if you take p to infinity, eventually you're going to approach this green line, which is a square, which is the norm of the, which is in fact the infinity norm. Okay. Now we have defined the p-norms. Now we still need to sort of relate these p-norms to the objective function that we originally wanted to solve, namely this discrete function that simply counts the number of entries. For this, what we can do, and this is a bit sloppy in terms of notation, we can define a function for p equal, we want to find to define something like a zero norm. And the definition is simply like this. We define the norms. So recall the definition we had here. This is only defined, or I don't even have it on the slide. Well, here I have it. So this is only defined for p, which is strictly greater than zero. Because otherwise, if you have p equals to zero, you would need to take 1 over zero. So this definition, this term is simply not defined. So to be able to define a p norm, p needs to be something that is not zero. Now we want to define it if p is zero. And we now do a different definition, which is maybe not the most obvious thing to do. But essentially what we want to do is we want to take p, like we want to look at a p norm and take its limit to zero, for p to zero. And the resulting thing, this is what we are going to call the zero norm of a function. And now you can see, if you write down this expression, this p norm to the power of p is essentially the sum over these entries to the power of p. Now we take the limit, so d is fixed, w is fixed, everything is fixed, just the p goes to zero. So the limit of this expression is w to the power of zero. And to the power of zero means it's one. No matter what w is, this is 1. Now you need to define it in a particular way. You need to define that 0 to the power of 0 is 0, and for any other number, a to the power of 0 is 1. This is well known. And if you have all that, then essentially this thing here is the zero norm, because, like in the sense that we have discussed before, then this expression is 1 if there is an entry that is non-zero, and it is 0 if the entry is 0, and then the sum counts the ones, which is, it counts the entries that are non-zero. So this is the kind of thing that we wanted to have. As a remark, this is not a norm. And this is why this notation is sort of a bit abusive. It suggests that there would be a norm, but it's not. Don't worry about it. It is still called the zero norm in the literature, but everybody is aware of the fact that this is not a norm. It doesn't even satisfy the homogeneity assumption. If you look at this kind of property here, this is not satisfied, so it can't be a norm. But still, people call it the zero norm. Okay, so now at the end of this excursion, what we have seen so far is what we would like to use as a regularizer is what we call the zero norm. This expression here, because this is exactly the kind of naive regularizer that we came up with. We simply want to count. Now, on the previous slide, I already said that this is probably NP-hard. This is not what we are going to use. And the reason why this is so difficult can also be seen from this figure here, because if you look at the contour lines for p-norms which are below, where p is below 1, these contour lines all of a sudden get this kind of star-shaped form, and this is not a convex set anymore. You can see that this is, for example, the norm for p equals 1/2. This is not convex anymore. So all the p norms for p between 0 and 1 are not convex anymore, and in particular p equals 0 is not convex, it's even discrete. Now we want to have a solution, and now this is what happens in very many machine learning problems. You have a certain function that you would like to optimize, but for some reason you can't optimize this function because it's a non-convex problem, for example, or it's a discrete function. And then what happens very often is people try to solve a relaxed version of the problem, where we try to find the closest convex function that approximates the function you're actually interested in. We will see this later a lot for loss functions, but now we have it in the context of a regularizer. We would like to minimize this zero norm. We can't do it. Now maybe what we do instead is we try to minimize some other norm which is as close as possible to the zero norm. Now if you consider this, maybe we go back to this image here, to the p norms. So what we would like to minimize is this p norm for p equals zero. So this would be, so the shape of this function would be essentially just a cross. And now we say, what is the closest norm for which this would become a convex set? So we increase p, increase p, increase p, until we finally end up at p equals 1. And this is the first point where we have a convex norm. And now what we say is, well, we can't optimize this this zero norm here, so we take the p norm for a value of p, which is as close to zero as possible but convex, so we take p equals 1. And for now, this is only a heuristic. This is a rule of thumb that you might want to do, and this is at this particular point, there's nothing that would guarantee you that when you do that, you end up with a solution that is still sparse or has anything to do with the solution that you would find if you would optimize the zero norm. So far, it's a hack. So what we are going to do is we settle for the one norm as a regularizer. And the big question is really whether it is still going to give us sparse solutions. And there is at this point no particular reason why this might be the case. But we will see on the next slide that there is in fact a reason why it's still, why we still might believe that this is going to work. Okay, and this is now a slightly complicated plot that I need to explain. And I maybe do it by redrawing the plot. Now what I want to show you is a bit of the geometry of this optimization problem. So what we're going to do is, so our plot on this slide is the parameter space. So be very careful about, we are not plotting the space of input points, we're just plotting the space of parameters. So assume we're in a two-dimensional setting, we want to learn two parameters, W1 and W2, and what I plot here are these two parameters. Oh, sorry, maybe I use the same kind of colors as we have in the... Remove it, make it black. So here's our coordinate system. We have W1 here and W2 here. And the W's are the parameters that we want to learn. What I have in green in this plot are now the contour lines of the empirical error. So we assume, so each point in this space of W1, 2 is one potential solution of our optimization problem. And now each of these solutions has a different training error. And what I can do now is I can plot the contour lines of this training error. So maybe the smallest training error would be at the center of this kind of ball in the plot, the green lines. And the further I go away, the higher the training error would be. So what I mean here is, like, if a point on this contour line has the particular coordinates indicated for W1 and W2, then this contour line tells you what is the current empirical error, and the empirical error increases as we go to the outside. Of course, it doesn't always look like this, but this is just a toy image to explain what's going on. So this is the empirical error. So if you wouldn't have any regularization, then we would pick the particular function, how can I do that with purple, indicated by this point in the middle, because this point in the middle has the smallest empirical error. This is without regularization. Now maybe I remove this line once more. Now I removed everything. I just draw it once more, sorry. So now here's again our coordinate system, W1, W2. We draw again the contour lines of the empirical risk. And now there's one other thing that I want to draw, namely the value of the regularizer. Because we're interested in what is the effect of a certain regularizer. And what I have now is here, this is what I have in red in this plot. Consider we use L2 regularization and assume that this ball is the set of points which have a constant W2 norm. So say on this ball we have W2 norm is 1. It's just constant. So from the point of regularization, all points on this red ball are equally nice. All of them have, or nice or not nice, whatever you like that, but they have the same kind of regularizer. So all of them have value 1. So from the regularization point of view, all of these points on the red ball are equally well suited to solve our problem. And now we need to check which one would be the solution that the algorithm would pick. We would now need to look at, say we know that we want to find a function that has regularizer 1. Then we need to find this function which has regularizer 1, which has the smallest empirical error. So we need to look at the contour lines of the empirical error and see where do these contour lines meet with the red line, and this might be at this point. So for these particular parameters, W1 and W2, we have the two norm of W is 1, and it has, like, among all the points which have L2 norm 1, it has the smallest empirical risk. Now observe that this is a solution that is not sparse. So here we have W1 and here we have W2, and both of them are non-zero. Okay? So here, this regularization did not really encourage us to find a solution that is sparse. And now we want to look at the L1 regularization. So I draw another figure. This is, I guess, easier than trying to erase it. So we have W1, W2. I plot again the contour lines. So this is again the empirical risk and the contour lines of the empirical risk. And now I draw the ball of the L1 norm. So it is supposed to be this diamond. So now these are all the points which have W1 norm equals to 1. And now we want to check among all the points in the space if we want to optimize both the regularizer and say we achieve W1 equals 1. And now we want to have a small empirical risk at the same time, which is the point we're going to pick. And now maybe I extend the contour lines again a bit more. And what you're going to find is, hopefully, that the solution is going to be this point here. So the point where these contour lines intersect with this red ball in like the diamond, sits on this y-axis, which means that if we look at what is the, so we have now this W2 value of the solution is non-zero, but the W1 value of the solution here is zero. In this sense, we have found a sparser solution because one of the coordinates is zero. And now you can even try to extend this, and I'm not going to redraw it once more on the slide. You can see it like if you even drive p smaller, you get this diamond shaped or like even more extremely shaped kind of unit balls. And then it's even more likely that you end up with points that sit on some of the coordinate axis. And this is the intuition why we think that if we use the L1 norm as a regularizer, it still might help us to find sparse solutions. There's another reason why one might argue that the L2 norm is really less suited to find sparse solutions as opposed to the L1 norm. So the L2 norm puts a particularly large penalty if you have very large coefficients. So what you try to achieve with L2 penalization is you want to, at all costs, to avoid large coefficients W1. You don't really care at all about whether you have many coefficients that are small, because they don't really influence the norm a lot. You just care about the fact, sort of, what is the maximum value in my W vector, and I try to get this maximum value as small as possible. This is what the L2 regularization does. The L1 one now does a different thing, because the way these large coefficients are penalized is not by the square, but just by the absolute value. So if you, again, consider what are the formulas for L1 and L2. So the W1 norm of a vector is the sum of the absolute values of the WE, sum goes over I. And if you look at the W2 norm squared, say, you have the sum of WI squared. And this fact, whether you have a square here or like a power of 1 here, this is what makes a big difference, because the square, if you have a large number, the square is even larger. So it really, really, really punishes large numbers. Whereas for the 1 norm, it doesn't punish these large numbers so highly. And in this sense, you can afford to have sort of small weights disappear and still have maybe a couple of high weights, but some of the small weights might disappear, whereas the same thing would not happen in the L2 norm. Okay, now we have all our ingredients. We now have established that we want to punish by looking at an L1 punishment, L1 regularization, and now our problem is going to look as follows. The input space is again an arbitrary space, the output space is the real line. We fix a set of basis functions, phi1 to phi d. Alternatively, you can say you start immediately with the space R to the d. We use linear functions, linear in these phi's, so we want to find these coefficients wi. And now we use as regularizer the L1 norm. Again, we have to choose a regularization constant, and then our optimization problem looks like this. We need to find the vectors w that minimize the sum of these two terms. The first term is the empirical error, still measured in L2 norm. So here we don't change the norm. It's still the L2 norm that considers our error. But the regularizer, by what we select, which are the functions that we would like to prefer, is now the L1 regularizer rather than the L2 regularizer. And this is the lasso. This is the optimization, the problem, the algorithm that is supposed to solve a regression problem given by the lasso. Maybe again consider this for a tiny bit. So this lasso objective function is convex. Again, I go back. This is the least squares loss function that is convex. We have already seen this many times. The one norm, we have discussed it also extensively, is a convex norm. So the sum of these two convex norms is again a convex function. Now, as opposed to regression and to ordinary least squares, we are now in a situation where we cannot compute an analytic solution of this problem anymore. So we cannot really just sit down, take the derivative and already see from a formula, solve it and find out what the solution is and plug it into a formula. In this case, we really need to run an optimization algorithm to find the solution. So typically what you do is, you now have your favorite optimization solver, you plug this optimization problem in your solver and you find the solution. Now, of course, there might be solvers that are more suited to this kind of problem, but this is something we are not going to discuss in this lecture at all. If you want to understand like what kind of solvers are most suitable for which kind of optimization problems, you would need to attend an optimization lecture. Here I just made a couple of comments. In general, you can of course use any convex solver. It is going to work, but it might be slow, for example, because it's not really adapted to the particular structure of your problem has. You can recast this as some kind of quadratic problem, which might help already to solve it. And then there exist other algorithms that are sort of essentially or adapted to the lasso problem. Coordinate descent algorithms and so on work better on this kind of problem, but as I said, we're not going to discuss them. I want to show you one example. It's the same example as the one we've seen before. Again, we have this kind of sine wave that we want to fit. We have the black points, which are our data points. The black line is the base optimal function. In the previous plot, it was called the regression function. The red line is now the rich regression function. And the blue line is the lasso function. So what you can see is both functions fitted to a certain way. I think this as by itself, it is not really so interesting. You see maybe that the rich regression has still a bit more variance than the lasso because of this fact that larger coordinates maybe introduce more variance. What I think is interesting is this particular plot, which now shows how the different kind of errors behave and also the number of non-zero components. So you have two different plots in this plot, which makes it a bit hard to digest. So the first thing I want, on the x-axis we have the regularization parameter lambda on a log scale again. So here it means lambda is close to zero. We essentially don't have any regularization because the regularization part is essentially doesn't play any role anymore. It is so tiny that in the objective function we only look at the empirical risk. On this other end of the scale, the lambda is very large, so all the attention of the algorithm is going to be on the regularization to try to find a small L1 norm and not so much anymore on finding a small empirical risk. What you can see here is the number of non-zero components in the solution, both for rich regression and for the lasso. And what you can see essentially this is at one. So for rich, and no matter what the regularization constant is, for rich regression, essentially all the constants are always non-zero. So none of these constants is, so we don't have a sparse solution, not even a single of these constants gets zero. Which makes sense because in rich regression we didn't pay attention to having any coefficients being zero. So this is something we didn't really consider in this particular problem. But we also see it doesn't really happen by chance. If we don't pay attention for it, as we do in rich regression, then we do not see any zero components. The green line, on the other hand, is the number of non-zeros for lasso. And we see at the beginning, if the regularization part is too small, if the constant is too small, essentially we don't regularize, so we have the same kind of solution as for Lasso, everything is non-zero. But as soon as the regularization starts to kick in, the number of non-zero components drops dramatically until at the very end it is really exactly zero. So here we regularized so heavily that all the components are zero, which means, well, the regularizer is perfect, but of course the empirical risk is not perfect anymore. And this is what we now can also see on these plots here. So maybe we first look at the test error for Lasso. This is the black dashed line. The training error for Lasso is this one. You see in the beginning the training error is, so this is also on a log scale. It's not really large, but it's larger. Then it drops up to a certain point here, which is the regularization parameter, maybe being -2 or 0. That's sort of the optimal. And then the training error increases. And here it's constant because essentially we learn the constant zero function. So here the training error is really large. And you see again, there is sort of a sweet spot for parameter lambda. In this case, it's maybe around -2, which gives us the best training error. And this is, of course, what we would be interested to find. What you can also see is the test error of ridge regression. You see in this particular example that for ridge regression in the end, for a different regularization parameter lambda, you also find a function that has more or less the same kind of test error as we had for Lasso. So these errors are both something like, well, it's on a log scale, so, and I don't know what the base is, I guess 2. Well, whatever. So both of them have the same amount of error here, just for a different regularization parameter, which makes sense because why should the regularization parameter be the same for the two different optimization algorithms? That's not the case typically. And then it tends to increase and also goes to a trivial error. Essentially, this is sort of, again, close to guessing level, I guess. You can also see, so this was for the test errors, which is what you don't see. Now we can look at the training error. The training error in Lasso, in the beginning, if we don't regularize at all, we pay lots of attention on the training error. But as we start to regularize, so here essentially at this point we see the green line dropping, so here regularization starts to play a larger role. And then we can also see that the test error, the training error slightly increases because our function tries to optimize the sum of training error and regularizer. And now it's maybe better to have a slightly larger training error but have a better regularization term. So the training error essentially increases here. And the same is true for ridge regression at the same time, because it's sort of a similar trade-off. If the regularization constant is zero, we only look at the training error. And as soon as regularization starts, we are going to take less weight on the training error, and the training error is going to achieve for the benefit of having a better regularization term. Okay. Now we're more or less at the end of the Lasso lecture. I still want to give you a bit of a historic perspective. So first of all, where does the name Lasso come from? It's a funny name for an algorithm. It stands for least absolute shrinkage and selection operator. So these are the first letters of these kind of words. It has been invented, as I said, already by Tip Shirani in 1996. So this is when it has been published for the first time, at least when the journal paper has been published. And there's an interesting also retrospective by Tip Shirani as well, which has been published in 2011 about sort of what is the historic perspective of Lasso. One has to say that this Lasso thing really started a whole new trend in statistics and machine learning, namely this L1 regularization. And we are going to see this a number of times in this lecture, that sparsity is something that we really would like to encourage, and that L1 regularization is one of the very good tools that helps you to achieve sparsity. This occurs in ridge regression, in regression here, but we also are going to see it later on, for example, in low-rank matrix methods, where we try to approximate matrices by other low-rank matrices and have similar phenomena. So the summary for the Lasso, we start with an arbitrary space. Our output, because we're in regression, is real-valued. The arbitrary space here is a bit misleading because we still need to have a feature representation that brings us to the space RD. the loss function is still the L2 loss, so don't be confused. It's only the regularizer that goes to L1. The loss is still L2. Our function class is still linear functions, as we had before, but the regularizer is now the L1 norm. And as opposed to all the other algorithms that we've considered before, this is a convex optimization problem, but there does not exist an analytic solution. So we need to solve the problem by looking at some, by throwing it into some convex optimization solver.